And let us exalt his name again. I'm so glad to be here with y'all. I mean, y'all have partied already. I mean, your pastor is so youthful, and I saw her up there dancing. I said, it ain't no excuse for none of us. But I am so glad to be here with y'all on Youth Day. I think everybody in here is a young person, the way y'all acting around here. Give an honor to your pastor, Pastor Calloway. Let's give her a hand. You know, it's an honor when a pastor allows you to come in and speak on a Sunday morning. And I don't take that for granted, and especially since I never met her, so she is really trusting whoever mentioned my name for me to come in. And I feel so honored that you would even allow me to come and speak to your flock. Give an honor to the fellow yoke servant, all those that's serving in the white uniforms behind me. Let's give them a hand. Ministers of the gospel. Give an honor to Elder Ambush and the youth staff. Let's give them a hand for a youth day. And I want you to give yourself a hand. Y'all looking so beautiful. So good with these beautiful hats on. I tell y'all, y'all remind me so much of my mother. Don't make no sense. I want to thank God for my wife, Jessica Finger. We've been married for 14 years. The best 14 years of my life. Stand up just so they can see. They want you to turn around and look at you. Thank God for her. She's been a blessing to me. Thank God for my kids, John and Hannah. Y'all can stand too. He like to get praise about this one. Let us all go in the book. Let's go to Nehemiah 1. Nehemiah chapter 1. And I don't do this that much, but y'all gonna have to have mercy on me. I want to read a little bit. So I hope that's all right with y'all. We're gonna go to Nehemiah 1. If you have it, say I have it. That sounds a little weak. Nehemiah's in the Old Testament. Nehemiah chapter 1. If you got a cheat, look at your concordance. Maybe that'll help you find out what page number is on. Nehemiah chapter 1. If you have it, say I have it. That sounds a whole lot better. We're going to start at the first verse. We're going to read a little bit, and we're going to cross over to the second chapter. The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hechaliah, and it came to pass in the month of Chislah, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan the palace, that Hananiah, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. And it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. And said, I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God, that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Let thy ear now be attentive, and thy eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now day and night. For the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee, both I and my father's house have sinned. We have dealt very corruptly against thee, and have not kept the commandments, nor the statutes, nor the judgments, which thou commandest thy servant Moses. Remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, if ye transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. But if ye turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out unto the uttermost part of heaven, Yet I will gather them from thence, and will bring them unto the place that I have chosen, to set my name there. Now there are thy servants, thy people, whom thou hast redeemed by thy great power, and by thy strong hand. O Lord, I beseech thee, let now thy ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant, and to the prayer of thy servants, who desire to fear thy name and prosper. I pray thee, thy servant this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. Let's pick up over in the beginning of Nehemiah, the second chapter. Now it came to pass in the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes, the king, that wine was before him. And I looked, and I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been before sad in his presence. Wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad? Because that ain't look good for the cupbearer to look sad. And he's about to take care of you. Seeing thou art not sick, this is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid, and said unto the king, let the king live forever. Why should not my countenance be sad when the city, the place of my father's sepulcher, lies waste, and the gates thereof are consumed with fire? Then the king said unto me, for what doest thou make request? So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said unto the king, if it please the king, and if thy servant have found favor in thy sight, that thou wouldest send me unto Judah, unto the city of my father's sepulchers, that I may build it. And the king said unto me, the queen also sitting by him, for how long shall thy journey be? And when wilt thou return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a time. Turn to somebody, and with all the anointing that you have, tell them, rebuild your walls. They act like they didn't get it. Turn to somebody else and tell them, rebuild your wall. Father, we need you this morning. We can do nothing of ourselves, but we're leaning on you right now. Feed your sheep. Heal your sheep. Deliver your sheep. Save your sheep right now. Satan, we bind you in every hand. You have no control or authority over this service, but Father is in your hands. Do what you want to do. Be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Rebuild your walls. I've been sent here on assignment because somebody in here needs deliverance. Now, if you feel like your walls are already up, then I need you to pray for somebody else right now, because they may need some deliverance this morning. Here it is, walking this walk of salvation. Sometimes while we're walking this walk, we go through peaks and valleys. Peaks and valleys. And sometimes while in the valley, we are dealing with internal issues. Issues down on the inside that the enemy may use to hold us in our own captivity. Our own captivity. And if we're in our own captivity, then we must be honest with ourselves to say that maybe our walls must be down. If you look at the church comes into existence really in the New Testament, but we use the Old Testament to find the parallel with Israel with what they have gone through. We can look at Israel and see parallels with the church in their relationship with God.
Yeah.
Here it is. They was in captivity down there in Egypt for 400 years. But God sent a deliverer by the name of Moses to deliver God's people. They were brought out of captivity, which is like a type and shadow of being brought out of sin.
Yeah.
Went out there to the Red Sea. did not know how they was going to get across. But we know in the Bible says that Moses extended the rod, God came down and made a highway right there in the river, right there in the water. And
yes,
he walked
Lord.
Through on dry ground. That was a type and shadow of baptism. They got out there in the wilderness. God took care of them while they was out there in the wilderness. There was no malls. There was no grocery stores. There was no restaurants. But God was everything that they needed. Not only did they stay out there, but God took them to the promised land. Here it is, they were slaves 40 years ago, but now they're free. Not only are they free, but God blessed them. They had houses that they did not build. They had vineyards that they did not plant. Let me tell you something. God knows how to take care of you. Before you got saved, some of y'all ain't had much of nothing. You didn't have them pretty hats. You didn't have them fancy shoes. You didn't have them fancy suits. But because God saved you, God blessed you in spite of. In spite of what you didn't know, God just bless you. Let me tell you something. When you get with God, that's all you need. Here it is. God blessed them. They was in the promised land. God delivered them. But it was while they was in the promised land that they started looking at the world. They started looking around them. And they decided that they wanted a king. Samuel didn't know what to do. He was upset because he thought they had rejected him. But God had to tell them, they didn't reject you.
He rejected me.
They rejected me. The first king God gave them what they wanted. He gave them what they thought that they wanted to have, and that was Saul. Saul walked like a king, looked like a king, but he did not have a heart for God. Did not stay obedient to God. Even though he served 40 years, because he did not fully obey God, God took him out of the picture. God raised up David, a man after his own heart. Here it is, David was out there, the youngest of his brethren. He was out there serving his father's flock. He had nobody's vote. Didn't have his daddy's vote. Didn't have Samuel's vote. But the only vote he had was God. That's the only vote that you need is God's vote. God anointed him. He anointed him to be king. When he got king, he became king over everything. Because the tribe had got divided when Saul died, and then his son Ishbosheth became king over Israel. Judah went to David, but the kingdom of Israel was Ishbosheth. But Ishbosheth got assassinated right in his bed. David became king over everything. It was while David was king that he went and attacked Jerusalem from the Jebusites, took over the city of Zion as his headquarters, because before then, Saul had the headquarters in Gibeah, but David established himself in Judah. He established himself in Jerusalem. It is while there that David penned Psalms 51, and he said, God, show your favor down on Jerusalem and build up the walls. David had a heart for God.
Yes, sir.
He had a heart to build God a house. But God did not give him the responsibility to build it because he was a bloody man. The Bible said that he made all the preparations and he died. Then the kingdom handed down to Solomon. It was Solomon that built the temple. But it was Solomon that also built the walls. Solomon never had to fight because he had 40 years of peace. Because the favor of God was upon him. When he dedicated the temple, the Bible says that the glory of the Lord fell down in the house. Fell down so hard that the priest could not even minister. And then Solomon prayed a prayer to God. God spoke to him in the middle of the night and said, I heard your prayer. And as long as the people do their part, my name shall be there.
Yes, Lord.
But the Bible lets us know that Solomon died. When Solomon died, that Rehoboam took over. He was worse than his daddy. He was a bad fellow. And because he was so bad that the kingdom was split, he had two tribes and Jeroboam had 10 tribes. Jeroboam was over Israel. When you look at all the kings that was over Israel from Jeroboam on down, it was 19 kings. All 19 was wicked. All of them was bad. There wasn't a good one in the sight. Even when you looked over on the other side, when you look down at all the kings from Rehoboam on down on the side of Judah, there was 19 kings and one queen. 12 of them was bad. 8 of them was only good. We're going to get down to the last two kings. When you look at the last two kings of Judah, here it is, Judah was in a bad state. The last two kings was terrible. They did not walk upright before God. The one before the last, his name was Joachim. He took over the kingdom when he was 18 years old. He walked wickedly before the Lord. Let me tell you something. You can't walk wicked without God doing something about that situation. God don't want to dwell there when you're not walking right. Here it is. God allowed Nebuchadnezzar to come in and besiege Jerusalem. Not only did Nebuchadnezzar come in, he attacked the temple. Stripped the gold off the temple. The same gold that Solomon put on there to dedicate to God. But when God sees that you walk wickedly before him, he'll strip you. Strip you of your glory. Strip you of your power. Strip you of your anointing. Because you won't walk right in him. Not only did he strip everything down, but Nebuchadnezzar took the king himself. Took a bow, took him, took his mama, took all the mighty men and brought them into captivity in Babylon. Yes. Then he placed into the king, he placed his uncle to be king, whose name was Mahadaniah, but he changed his name to Zedekiah. Zedekiah began to reign when he was 21 years old. You would think he would have learned from the lineage. You would have think he would have saw the signs that was writing on the wall to say, maybe I need to walk upright.
Yes, sir.
But he did just as bad as the rest of them. He walked wickedly before the Lord. Let me tell you something. God had to come in. But let me tell you something. God will send you warnings. He will send you messages saying, I want you to turn around. Jeremiah was preaching. He was preaching the word that God gave him, telling the people to repent, telling the people to turn. But Zedekiah did not turn. Zedekiah got upset. Not only did Zedekiah get upset, but the pulpit got upset. The other priests got upset and said, why don't you take Jeremiah and tie him up somewhere? They took Jeremiah and put him in a cistern because they got tired of hearing him. They wanted to kill him, but they was afraid to kill him. But they put him down in a cistern, and they hoped that he wasn't going to get no food to die. But let me tell you something. God don't leave his prophets behind. The Bible says that Jeremiah got saved even though he was down in the cistern. God sent deliverance to Jeremiah. Nebuchadnezzar was sent back. Sent back to get Zedekiah because Zedekiah tried to rebel. But he went back and got Zedekiah and had him bound to Babylon. Killed all his sons in front of his eyes. Then he had his eyes put out and made him to be a slave. Made him to be locked down in captivity. Can you imagine? The same Israel that had just came out of captivity with Egypt. Now they find themselves back in captivity. That's the one thing about sin. Sin will lock you up. Sin will have you bound. Sin will have you locked down where you can't even have control of yourself. That's just the effects of sin. Find yourself locked in captivity. Here it is. As we look at the story, we see Nehemiah and he gets a report. He gets a report on back on the homeland because he's the cupbearer for the king. But he gets a report back on the homeland. When he hears about the homeland, he's disturbed because he knew what he had heard of old of what Jerusalem used to be like. Here it is, now you find that the city is burned. Not only is the city is burned, but the walls are torn down. Not only are the walls torn down, but the gates are torn down. Back in those days, see, we don't understand it. We're over here in America, and we live in a democracy, but we don't know what it's like to be in the kingdom. A kingdom is known by how the city is fortified. It's known by its walls. Because if the walls are down, you are exposed to the enemy. You are exposed to the wild animals. You are exposed to the elements. You are exposed to attack because the walls are down. Nehemiah was disturbed. He was upset. He didn't know what to do. All he could do was get down on his knees and pray to God. Push this plate back and he began to pray before God. I don't care what the stress that you may be in. I don't care how low you may think you are in. You gotta know how to get down on your knees and cry out to your God. Ah, he got there and he got to praying. And he said, Lord, now give me favor. Give me favor when I go into these men. Ah, he's the cupbearer. He's the man right next there to the king. Cupbearer was just not a regular little slave, but a cupbearer got power because you got the ear of the king. Ah, the king saw him and he saw his face. His face looked disturbed, and the king started getting a little scared because he did not know what's going on. Because he know that he's the cupbearer and he's about to give me some wine. I'm looking a little scared because I don't know what's in this wine. And you're looking a little bit disturbed. Say, what's on your heart? Nehemiah told him what's on his mind. He told him the homeland. My homeland is disturbed. Where my father's from, the walls and the gates are burned down. Ah, the king says, look, why don't you go back home? Do what you got to do to build the walls back up, to build the gates back up. I'm only going to talk about one gate.
Go ahead.
There are 10 gates to the city, but I'm only going to talk about one gate.
Yes, sir.
If you go back to Nehemiah, the third chapter, it starts with this gate and it ends with this gate. That gate is the sheep gate. That was the first gate that they worked on. That gate was responsible for all the sheep to come in. The priests, they was responsible for repairing that particular gate because that gate was tied to them. Because that was the gate for them to offer up the sacrifices throughout the day. Here it is. We got to offer up sacrifices. We are that living sacrifice. We got to offer up sacrifices every day for our lives. We got to commit ourselves to the Lord. We don't need another lamb. Jesus was the only lamb that we needed. But we was the ones that should have been on the chopping block.
Yes, sir.
We was the ones that should have been on the cross. And every day you got to sacrifice your life. Now I'm talking about rebuilding the wall now. Rebuilding the walls of your own life. Because that's where we have the problem at. That's where the issues are at. Because our walls are down. A wall doesn't mean anything unless you have a gate. The gate controls what goes out and what comes in. Now I said the city had 10 gates. I'm only going to deal with 3 for us that we got to get control of. The ear gate, the eye gate, the mouth gate. The ear gate, the eye gate,
the mouth gate.
What you hear can go in your spirit. What you see can go in your spirit. And what you say, you can speak in your spirit. And we have exposed ourselves to things not knowing. We're tearing our own wall down.
Come on.
Because what you have heard and what you have saw and what you have said have laid seeds in your spirit that the devil is using you to hold you in captivity. It's easy to see the backslide of that left.
Go ahead, man.
What about the one that's in the house?
But there are some backsliders that come to church faithful. They on the usher board. They sing in the choir. They deacons. And they may even preach.
Go ahead.
Uh-oh.
Preacher.
Captivity means, because you're a slave, you don't control when you wake up. You don't control when you go to sleep. You don't control the work you do. Because you're a slave and you're in captivity. If the devil has a yoke on you where you don't have control of yourself, you're in captivity. Some sins are strongholds because you are addicted to it. And we love to talk about fornication. We love to talk about drunkenness. We love to talk about all the other sins. But then there's some other sins we do we don't even talk about. Backbite. Respect the persons. That's what we do. Jealousy, envying, malice, hatred. But we want to shout. We want to sing. We want to display like we got power. We have a form of godliness, but we're denying the power. God want to change you from the inside out. And you got to rebuild your wall. Isaiah 58. This is steps down to rebuilding. He said, cry aloud, spare not. Lift up that voice like a trumpet. Show my people their transgressions. Show the house of Jacob their sins. But he goes on down and says, is not this the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bands of wickedness. And that you break every yoke. You may not have no power to do anything else, but God gave you the tools to build back your walls. You got to push that plate back.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Y'all don't want to hear that one. You don't want to hear that one. Oh, I can just feel it. I can just feel it. I can just feel that flesh saying, no. You got to call yourself on your own personal fast.
Hallelujah.
Oh, yeah, I hear it. Somebody's saying, what does not eating a burger got to do with rebuilding my wall? When you fast, you're bringing that flesh underneath subjection. That flesh ain't never getting saved. That's why you say mortify the deeds. That flesh ain't never getting saved. But to take the strength from the flesh, you stop eating. Now you're allowing the spiritual man to breathe. Probably ain't felt breathing like that in a long time. We sit up and say, oh, I ain't got strength to pray. Flesh too strong. Oh, it's just so hard to live right. Flesh is too strong.
Too strong.
Well, how long should I fast? You fast as long as you physically can take, as God leads you to do it, because I don't want you to die. But there's a level that you can hit where you can start getting some spiritual clarity to hear God. We give people a good show. I've been saved a long time. And I done seen a lot of stuff. I have been to the point where everybody's shouting. And I said, what are they shouting for? Because I'm going through at that moment, because I said we go through peaks and valleys. You go through ice and cold sometimes. That's why he said, I will you was not lukewarm, I will you be hot or cold. Because we go through our moments. But to get the fire of the Holy Ghost burning again, you got to heat up them cold. You got to heat them up. God said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. But when you cutting up, he just sit back. Now he's gently nudging you. We got the preachers, they preaching, word is coming, You got the altar workers, we wear them out. Got the praise team, we wear them out. Trying to get you revitalized. But it's your job to rebuild your own wall. And deliverance will come. Because God wants you fortified. That's what the whole armor is. It's fortification. Being armed from the head, down. So that you're protected from the enemy. God wants you victorious. He don't want you bound. He sees your tears. He sees you in the middle of the night when you ain't got control of yourself. He sees you. And he wants you free. But you got to use what you got. Don't make no sense having a weapon if you ain't got no bullets in it. You got the Holy Ghost. But when it checks your heart and there's no word there, because you use your ears and your eyes and your mouth to sow other things into your heart, the Holy Ghost can't move like it wants to. Oh, y'all don't believe me. Let's go to Genesis. The Holy Ghost was moving. Since the Spirit was moving. But it wasn't doing nothing. To God saying, let there be. When he said, let there be, then the Holy Ghost started working. Because it's the action part of God. You got the Holy Ghost down on the inside of you. But if you have not sowed no word, if you have not spoken no word over your life, it's not operating like it should. He's a keeper. The difference between us and the stories we hear of the saints of old, they were disciplined in their walk, disciplined in their routine, disciplined in seeking God. But we can't go from revival to revival, convention to convention, conference to conference, heating up like coals. We got to stay hot. God wants your walls up. Now, there's somebody here that's not saved. You need to build a wall. Because right now you are totally exposed. The devil is going in and out of your city, and you have no control over it. You're his territory. But God want to save you today. First thing he does, you got to repent. You got to repent. You got to say, I'm sorry for what I've done. I don't want to do this no more. Then you got to go down in Jesus' name. That blood will come in your city, your life, and wash it clean.